welcome to Legislative Report with Senator Jesse Hamilton. I'm Julia Locandy. Hi, Senator. How are you?
Great, Julia. How are you doing today?
Very well. So today we're going to talk about the budget.
Great.
The fiscal plan was enacted. $142 billion for this state budget. And I know that you have concerns with some of the things that were put into it.
Yeah, the budget was a comprehensive budget. People fail to realize that Brooklyn, my district, is the largest county in New York State. 2.4 million people with a lot of needs, the most diverse borough in the state of New York. Education is a key component. Education is key for our children transitioning into the middle class. Even though we got $1.3 million, we should have gotten a lot more money. The gap elimination, we funded it more, we funded it more with $600 million, but still the schools in New York City are being underfunded. We still have old textbooks. We don't have enough after-school programs. We don't have enough certified teachers teaching math and science. So we are appreciative of the money, the increase in the funding, but we still have a long way to go.
So what about the DREAM Act? I know that you supported the DREAM Act, right? And that wasn't included in the budget.
Yes, the DREAM Act, we have a very large immigrant population, Orthodox Jewish people, Asian, Latin American. And it's disheartening to see students. I met a young lady who had a 4.0 GPA, whose parents come to this country working two and three jobs and basically wanting to live the American dream as so many other immigrants come into this country. And as we see the Statue of Liberty, you know, encouraging people to come to the United States, the people who are working the hardest are not being given an opportunity to excel academically. And to me, it's common sense is to give children money, not to pay for their full tuition, but just an assistance so they can become productive citizens in our community and give back to our system. And so I will always continue to fight for the DREAM Act to make sure all children, regardless of your documentation, have an opportunity to live the American dream.
Right. So that wasn't put in the budget, but you know, session is until June 17th.
Yes.
So you're going to try to work on that and just try to get it enacted.
Yeah, enacted, because it passed in the assembly, and we're close to it in the Senate. And I think people have to look at it that this country was built on immigration. Everybody here is an immigrant. You know, the true founders of this country were American Indians. So I don't understand why we're making a distinction now with the current immigrant population that's coming into this country.
So what are some things that you agree with in the budget?
Well, I agree with the budget, with the increased funding for CUNY SUNY, with the TAP allocation. A lot of students are having a hard time paying for tuition. At one point in New York State, CUNY and SUNY were free to students. But as the minimum wage is stagnant and you have to choose between paying your rent and paying tuition, that shouldn't be the case. We need to encourage our young people to get educated. So we have to make sure they have the funding in place. And also not to have a large student loan debt when they come out of college, which is now an albatross around a lot of our students as they come out of school.
Yeah, so you want sensible economic development initiatives as well.
Yes, you know, throughout the state, upstate New York is suffering from employment as far as job creation. New York City is doing a great job in job creation, but we have a food desert as far as vegetables and fresh fruit. Mm-hmm. And so we have a lot of small farmers upstate New York who are struggling. And I'm for sending our young kids who are underemployed in New York City to work on farms in upstate New York to get the stronger work ethic. And then the farmers in upstate New York can make more money in bringing their fresh produce from the Hudson Valley down into New York City. So I think we always look at Wall Street as being the catalyst for economic growth. But I think the people on the ground in the community, like the Commissioner Richard Ball from Agriculture and the governor, have a better sense on how to stimulate job growth within the state.
Yeah, good point about farming. I mean, that's the number one industry in the state of New York.
And people fail to realize that. They always think about construction, they think about Wall Street, mm-hmm. but farming is the backbone, and tourism. And we can enhance the relationship and economic interaction between downstate and upstate. We have 8 million people in New York City, and we should not be getting our produce from outside the state, but we have an abundance of fresh fruit here in New York State.
Right. Mm. So the hospital closures in Brooklyn have really impacted healthcare. What capital did your district get for healthcare?
For healthcare, we've allocated $700 million for Brooklyn. I think we should have gotten much more than $700 million. Oneida County has gotten $300 million for their healthcare system, but they only have 233,000 people. We have 2.4 million people. So I think there's a disparity in allocation of funding for healthcare. You know, we have, Downstate Medical Center, which is the only medical school in Brooklyn. We produce more doctors of color than any other where in the state. We have Kings County Hospital in my district. We have Kingsbrook Medical Center in my district. We have Lutheran Hospital in my district, Brookdale Hospital in my district, Interfaith Hospital in my district. I have more hospitals in my district than any other senator in the state. And we have a high obesity rate. We have a high blood pressure rate. We have a high mental illness rate in Brooklyn. So even though it sounds like a lot, I don't believe we need a new hospital. I think we need to secure the hospitals that we have. There has been rumors of creating a new hospital, but downsizing other hospitals. I think we could downsize the hospitals, but we have to maintain the integrity of healthcare service. And also, there are a lot of jobs. Downstate is the fourth largest employer in Brooklyn. And so it has a multiplier effect for small business owners in the community, the housing market, and and employment in the immediate vicinity. So not only is it a teaching hospital, not only is it a medical hospital, but it's also an employer in the community. And we need to make sure we don't eliminate that school or hospital and keep union jobs. We need union jobs. The average home now in my district is close to $1 million, between $750,000 to $1 million for a home. And as wages are stagnated, a lot of children are not being able to stay in the communities in which they are being raised. So that's another aspect of what's going on. So we need to keep the union jobs. And I think unions are being scapegoated, from teachers to nurses to, firefighters. Like, they get paid too much. But we're not looking at the other side. Why should an investment bank on Wall Street, get a bonus of $3 million? We need some more equity on the ground.
What about the housing part of this budget? Does that meet the needs of your district?
No, it does not. With the NYCHA development, I have one of the largest NYCHA developments in New York City, in Brownsville, and I've walked through every development from the top floor to the first floor, and we still have outdated elevators, which are always broke. In the complexes, half the buildings have only one elevator button. There's no up, there's no down. And at nighttime, women have to walk down the stairs because they're scared when they get on the elevator. They don't know if it's going up or down. This is the year 2015, and we don't have up and down elevator buttons. The windows are spray painted black, so you think you're in the mental facility. It has the highest murder rate in New York City, the highest incarceration rate in New York City. So we need more funding for housing for maintenance, more lighting. A young man was shot by a police officer because the stairwell was dark and the officer was scared. We need more maintenance for the elevators. And we just need to hire the people who live in the complex to work in the complex. We have buildings that have they have no after-school programs, but we have vacant space just waiting there. So we're working with the IDC, with the Senate Republicans, to acquire $100 million, but not to be used by NYCHA for capital improvements as far as old refrigerators, old stoves. And so NYCHA does need more money. And they're starving NYCHA. So they're saying the parking lots are not being utilized. Well, if you charge a NYCHA resident $600 to park, they can't afford it. So NYCHA increased the rates for parking. People pull their cars out of the parking lots, and then they say, well, the parking lots are being underutilized. Now we're going to sell the land. So to me, why would you want to sell the land when you can build and have affordable housing? I'm not saying for all low-income people. We have to have a diversified, market rate, affordable rate, and low-income rate. And have it integrated. You just can't have a lot of people in a certain economic level living there. So we have a ways to go with NYCHA, but I believe that we should invest in our own real estate rather than in selling the real estate. Because once you sell it, you don't get it back. And at one point in time, the city was selling real estate, and it was a great idea. But that was in 1975 when the city was burning. Now Brooklyn is the hottest place on the planet. Everybody wants to come to Brooklyn. And so you don't have to give land away anymore. We just need to maintain those folks who've been here for a prolonged period of time who just want to stay in the communities where they were born.
Right. And the rent regulations, that never made it into the budget, but it expires in June.
Yes, the rent regulation is very serious. People don't realize I have 7 shelters in my district. Out of those 7 shelters, only 2 have eating facilities. So you have people living in shelters with no kitchen facilities to cook food. So just imagine your children living off of fast food. How does that affect them, you know, as far as their mental state, as far as them having healthy foods? You know, healthy foods, healthy minds. You know, Chinese food and pizza and fast foods is not a healthy a diet. And so right now in New York City, there are 1,800 children being born in shelters. 1,800 children every year being born in a shelter. And there's no follow-up with as far as healthcare monitoring, no follow-up to see how the children are doing. And they call these children the, they don't have suitcases, so they walk around with garbage bags with their clothes in it, from shelter to shelter, from aunt's house to cousin's house. Mm-hmm. And these are the children that are going into the school system, of which in some of the schools in my district, 23% of the children there come from homeless shelters. But then the state education department wants to put 50% of that child's score on teacher evaluation. That's not fair to the teacher. If you have a child coming from a shelter, from an unstable household, not getting the supportive services they need, and they say, oh, what, school teacher, you should fix this problem by yourself. It's unconscionable, and that's why I'm fighting to make sure that teachers are not scapegoated to solve social issues that the state should be doing with other agencies.
Yeah, you have a different solution than what was talked about throughout the budget to make sure our kids get the best education. Let's take a look at that right now.
Okay, thank you. I see in the bill we put a lot of emphasis on the teachers in turning schools around. But I want to get to the point, there seems to be no emphasis on the state education department on turning the system around. Right now, we have Black and Hispanic students only graduating at a 60% ratio. Only 15% of Black and Hispanic students are ready for college. So we're putting emphasis on the teachers, but we're not putting emphasis on the person or the entity that's in charge of the state educational department. So my question is, how much time do we give the state education department to turn around the system?
You want to elaborate on that?
Yes, I believe everything starts from the top. And we're looking at the teachers and saying, if you can't turn around a school, or if you can't change a child's test grades within 2 years, then your tenure could be jeopardized and the school will go into receivership. But presently, the state education department doesn't have a permanent commissioner. And they are pushing out policies like, you know, the Common Core, and they're pushing out policies as far as teachers' tenure, 50% evaluation, but we're not evaluating the state education department, who's evaluating school systems and teachers. To me, if you only have 15% of the population for Black and Hispanic kids ready for college, then the state education department itself should be looked at and turned around. Because how can you judge other schools and systems when you're not doing the job yourself? Mm-hmm. So college education is key now to get any job of significance. But yet only 15% of Black and Hispanic kids are ready for college. That's not a good barometer of the system. When I asked the Senator Flanagan to give a letter grade for the state education department, 2 times, he couldn't give me an answer. He pivoted. He wouldn't give the state education department a letter grade on their performance. He would not give me a time frame of how long a commissioner should stay in that position if they didn't turn around the system. So there seems to be no emphasis on the top, but more emphasis on the teachers and the school systems. And I think we have to change that dynamic. We have to put more emphasis on who's at the top leadership position, teaching our kids over, you know, millions of children with no accountability at the top. $44 billion is a lot of money. And we should make sure that that money is used efficiently in educating our kids. And we're still using textbooks. Most of our kids are computer literate. And they can, you know, go to the cloud and pull down information. But a lot of teachers, sometimes they need to be retooled and retrained.
Right.
And so, you know, I think we have to move forward in technology. Our kids are ready. We have to make sure that we have more certified math and science teachers. I was a school board president, and we had 24,000 kids, only 8 certified math teachers. We had the 5th best school in New York State, the Crown School for Law and Journalism. And we emphasized parental involvement. parental involvement is key. The state wants to move away from parental involvement. The school is the epicenter of community involvement with after-school programs, parents getting involved in meetings. And we're trying on the state level to privatize our school system. You cannot make education a for-profit entity. For-profit means what it means. It means that to make as much profit as possible and give less resources to our school system. So I'm going to be an advocate, and I'm going to fight for not privatizing our schools, our public schools. Because when you do that, the children who are coming from the homeless shelters, whose parents are not don't have the wherewithal to fight for their rights, they're going to suffer. And so I'd rather put the money in the front end than the back end. Why are we paying $60,000 a year to incarcerate a child? $60,000 a year. In 10 years, you're talking about $600,000 to incarcerate one person. We call them million-dollar blocks. We have million-dollar blocks in the poorest neighborhoods in New York City and throughout New York State where we're incarcerating young men and women rather than tracking them in pre-K and saying if the child is not on grade level, let's give them supplemental help and education to make sure they stay on grade level and not just tell a teacher if they don't make the grade level, it's your fault. No, we need social workers. We need after-school programs. We need more enrichment programs to help these children. Every child can learn. Every child is a precious commodity. But we just have to make sure we give them the resources they need to do that.
We are out of time, but I really hope that you stay on track with that because it makes so much sense.
And thank you so much, Julie. You've been doing a phenomenal job.
Thank you for watching Legislative Report with Senator Jesse Hamilton. For additional information on the budget, hamilton.nysenate.gov.